It has been said that the three things you shouldn't talk about in public are sex, politics, and religion. Well, this channel has clearly broken that so-called rule by talking almost exclusively about politics. And while we haven't talked about sex yet, we are going to be talking today about religion, specifically the changing role and position of religion in the Soviet Union. I'm your host, David, and today we are going to be looking at the changing nature of religion in Soviet life. This is the Cold War.
A sponsor that you can eat? What more could you desire? Boxu is a monthly snack box subscription service that delivers original assortments of premium Japanese snacks and tea pairings right to your door. Every month, you'll receive a box with a different theme. The snacks will always be different, so it becomes a new gourmet journey through Japan every month. This month's box, Prefecture Passion, will take you on a tasting tour of the various different prefectures of Japan. Our favorite has got to be the dried persimmon mochi, definitely a traditional treat. Boxu makes such a perfect and memorable gift for anyone in your life who appreciates Japanese snacks and culture, especially during a time when people aren't able to travel as easily as they would like. Actually, not only would you be gifting them Boxu, which is already awesome, but you would also be gifting them the chance to win free tickets to Japan, because Boxu is having a giveaway. They will be picking five lucky winners to win a free set of tickets, and anyone who's subscribed before December 31st is automatically entered. The link is in the description. Check out the terms and conditions and other methods of entry. Don't forget to use our code COLDWAR10 and the link in the description to get 10% off and save up to $47 on your own authentic Japanese subscription box from Boxu.
No doubt you're all aware that atheism, the lack of belief in the existence of God or gods, was a core and indivisible part of Soviet and communist ideology. Even before the actual establishment of the Soviet state, and certainly afterwards, the revolutionary leadership, from Lenin to Khrushchev, adopted policies to confront and liquidate religion from Soviet life, in line with the Communist Manifesto's declaration, "Communism begins where atheism begins." Official Soviet policy was to be an uninterrupted process of propaganda, legal measures, and violence against organized religion, religious communities, the practice of religion, and its religious symbols. But it isn't really possible to explain the role that religion played in the Soviet Union and its impact during the Cold War without explaining the role religion played in the Russian Empire. So that's where we're going to start. Throughout the history of the Russian Empire, the Russian Orthodox Church wielded enormous power. Orthodox Christianity was the official religion of the empire, and following the fall of Constantinople, not Istanbul, Russia became the power center of Eastern Orthodoxy. The vast majority of the subjects of the empire were Orthodox, and many, including many of the Tsars, were themselves quite pious. The Orthodox Church used their power to not only enrich themselves, but also to involve themselves in the politics of the empire in order to help maintain the absolute power of the Tsars. Now, as you can well imagine, the Orthodox Church was no supporter of the Bolshevik Revolution, nor were the Bolsheviks big fans of the Church. In fact, the Church was an early target of Lenin, who declared the nationalization of all Church land on November 8, 1917. This was followed by further attacks on Church power, including making all religions in the former empire legally equal, the transfer of all school and seminary properties which had belonged to the church to the Ministry of Education, the liquidation of obligatory church marriage, as well as the abolishment of the government subsidy for the maintenance of church buildings and the payment of the clergy. These were sweeping changes. And there were more. On January 13, 1918, the decree on separation of church and state and church and school was made, which proclaimed the following. 1. The church was now separate from the state. 2. All privileges related to confessional belonging were abolished. 3. Every citizen had a right to belong or not to belong to any confession. 4. All religious ceremonies were removed from public and state proceedings. 5. The practice of religion and religious ceremonies could continue, but on the condition of not disturbing public order or infringing on the rights of other citizens. 6. The population registry would now only be kept by civil authorities. 7. Religious education was forbidden. And 8. The church was prohibited from having possessions and had to give up all of its property. Now, it's one thing to make decrees and pass laws. It's another to implement and enforce them. To do this, dedicated departments were formed in the People's Justice Commissariat, Ministry of Internal Affairs, and Ministry of Education, which would oversee the implementation and enforcement of religious policy in the new Soviet state. The Cheka, the forerunner of the GPU, OGPU, NKVD, NKGB, MGB, KGB, was also heavily involved in the enforcement process. In conjunction with all of this, the Communist Party program called for, quote, the organization of the broadest possible anti-religious propaganda, end quote. By the mid-1920s, anti-religious propaganda was becoming more centralized in its efforts, fronted by publications such as Revolutsiya i Tserkov, that's Revolution and Church, while Nadezhda Krupskaya, Lenin's wife, was in charge of efforts to liquidate religion from the new Soviet education system. But, and here's the but, it was becoming quite apparent at the same time as these efforts were being made that persecution and propaganda would not be enough to eradicate religion in the Soviet Union. Which makes sense, really. For those raised in a faith-based society, there are cultural norms, practices, and mores that are deeply ingrained into everyday life. They aren't going to go away simply because the government told them to give it up. So if you can't beat them, join them, and then rip it down from the inside. In 1922, the state approved a project which established the Living Church as an alternative to the Russian Orthodox Church. It was made up of so-called progressive priests who would be publicly supportive of Soviet policies. By 1925, it was quite clear that the Living Church was just not working, so the Communist Party, by this time coming under the consolidated leadership of Stalin, formed the League of the Godless, which was tasked to aggressively push an atheist message while simultaneously attacking religious practices in society. Despite their efforts, religiosity persisted in the Soviet Union. Never one to be discouraged by a setback, Stalin, himself a former seminary student you will recall, introduced the Godless Five-Year Plan in 1928. Through this plan, many religious leaders were arrested and even executed on the grounds of being anti-revolutionary. Churches, mosques, and synagogues were destroyed or even converted into museums of atheism. The weekly day of rest, Friday, Saturday, or Sunday, depending if a person was Muslim, Jewish, or Christian, began to be rotated through the week in order to prevent the traditional day of prayer. 1929 saw further restrictions introduced on the practice of religion in the Soviet Union when religious gatherings were banned. The legal definition of clergy was even changed to be servants of the cults, and they had to be registered with the authorities in order to work in the religious sphere. This ongoing campaign had a significant outward impact. By the eve of the Great Patriotic War, organized religion had found itself significantly weakened. For example, in 1917, there had been approximately 50,000 churches in the Russian Empire, but by 1939, the number in the Soviet Union had dropped to a meager 200. Additionally, the classes of people who had arguably been the most observant, the peasantry, had been forced into collectivized communes, making daily monitoring much easier, and since the role of religion had been all but erased from political life, overt religiosity was very rare indeed. But despite all of this, the 1937 census still showed that 56% of Soviet citizens identified as believers. Even with all the efforts to stamp out religious belief from both social and political life, and even in the face of the totalitarian Stalinist state, well, religion finds a way, to paraphrase Jeff Goldblum. Okay, now, so far, much of the focus has been on the Orthodox Church, being the most popular religion as well as the one with the greatest official legacy from the old empire. But this certainly wasn't the only major religion, as a large portion of the Soviet population, especially in the Central Asian republics, were Muslims. Soviet policy towards Islam did not always follow the same aggressive policies that were used against the Orthodox Church. One of the major reasons for this was the simple fact that Islam was not in a position to challenge the Bolsheviks for power. Another reason was, well, more practical. In the Muslim-dominated regions of the Soviet Union, Islam was not just a spiritual religion, but an indivisible part of life, including setting the legal, societal, and even financial framework for the Ummah. Any effort to suppress Islam before a proper consolidation of power would have likely been met with a fierce backlash. Finally, the anti-colonial and anti-imperial rhetoric employed by the Soviets was met quite favorably with people in the Middle East, a region the Soviet Union was eager to gain influence with. The fear was that any excessive attacks on Islam would sour any burgeoning relationships in the region. On November 24, 1917, Lenin and Stalin wrote a letter entitled "To All Toiling Muslims of Russia and the East," in which they assured the rights of Muslims in Soviet Russia and called for their support for the revolution. Officially, there were anti-religious policies in place for Central Asia, but the central authorities still advised local communists to not be too overzealous in their actions. This included using only native communists to distribute atheist and anti-religious propaganda in order to help avoid the imperialist stigma. This didn't prevent the burning of some mosques or the execution of some mullahs, contributing to the Basmachi revolt in the Ferghana Valley, but overall there was more leniency than was practiced against the Orthodox Church. For anybody interested in a deeper dive on the Basmachi revolt, the Great War Channel talks more about it in their coverage of the Russian Civil War in Central Asia. Now, this leniency lasted until 1924, after which more strident policies were introduced. A new mosque faction was introduced, similar to the Living Church, which was tolerated by the authorities provided they preached support for the communists and preached against British imperialism. Certainly a legacy of the 19th century great game. Propaganda and persecution marched hand in hand in an effort to decrease the role of religion in the Muslim-dominated areas of the Soviet Union. In 1926, the Sharia courts were liquidated and responsibilities, such as the registration of marriages and births and the like, were assumed by the civic authorities. 1927 saw Stalin launch the Hujum campaign. Hujum is a Turkic word meaning storming or assault, and the campaign was directed towards overcoming the large degree of gender inequality that existed in Muslim-dominated regions. It focused on ending the practice of female seclusion, of polygamy, and of veiling. The Hujum campaign was launched on March 8th, International Women's Day, with hundreds of thousands of women across Uzbekistan burning their veils. Now, this is also where I should point out that the majority of these women went right back to wearing the veil, as their actions had been met with a great deal of aggression in the conservative and patriarchal Uzbek society. Women who persisted in not wearing the veil became subject to open harassment, threats, and even violence. Veiling also became a symbol of defiance and protest towards the Soviet regime. The Hujum campaign did result in increased rates of female literacy and the expansion of women's role in open society, including the labor force, but it also highlighted to the authorities that any attempts to openly and directly attack Islam in the Muslim-dominated regions of the USSR would likely backfire, even during the most oppressive periods of Soviet governance. Okay, so that was a brief summary of religion in the Soviet Union before the Cold War. Some of you may be wondering why we haven't addressed the third major religion in the Soviet Union, Judaism. We aren't really talking about it here because we are planning on doing an episode strictly on that, as it is an extremely complex and nuanced subject with an awful lot of misinformation, disinformation, and just outright lies and prejudice surrounding it, so we're going to give it a more focused examination at a later date. Now, the place of religion shifted significantly with the onset of the Great Patriotic War. The Germans, finding themselves in control of huge swaths of Soviet territory, began a practice of reopening churches to earn the sympathies of the local populations. Stalin, seeing few other options, began to allow churches to reopen in Soviet territory with the aim of using them to help the mobilization process to stop the Nazi advance. The church responded by stating, quote, "Our Orthodox Church has always shared the fate of the people. It has always borne their trials and cherished their successes. It will not desert the people now. The Church of Christ blesses all the Orthodox defending the sacred frontiers of our motherland. the Lord grant us victory. It's quite the statement from an organization that had, until only recently, been the subject of intense persecution, but highlights the deep and historic bond that existed between the Orthodox Church and Russia. Along with prayers and spiritual support, the church also collected money that was used for the purchase of weapons and supplies, as well as to provide aid to widows and orphans. Anti-religious propaganda was halted, and priests directed to reopen churches. An official church publication was even allowed, the Journal Moskovskoy Patriarchy, or Journal of Moscow Patriarchy. The journal was still subject to heavy censorship and had a limited circulation, but that it was allowed to exist at all could be considered quite, well, miraculous. And this tolerance wasn't just applied to the Orthodox Church, it was also extended to Islam. The Central Religious Board of Islam, located in Ufa, made a call in July of 1941 for Soviet Muslims to rise up in defense of their native land, to pray in the mosques for the victory of the Red Army, and to give their blessings to the sons fighting for a just cause. In August, Muslim leaders, both religious as well as from the communities, made an appeal to the Muslims of the world to fight against the German fascists. The Soviet government established four Islamic governing bodies, each to cover geography as well as sect, both Sunni and Shia. Several conferences were organized for community leaders in Ufa, Tashkent, and Baku, and along with the reopening of some mosques, came the opportunity for a very select few to go on Hajj to Mecca. By war's end, a hybrid approach to religion had been established. 1945 still saw the Central Committee of the Communist Party call for all communists to fight against the superstitions of religion while promoting science. On the other hand, religious activities continued to be tolerated. The 22nd of August 1945 saw the government adopt a secret decision which allowed the church to own its own means of transport, to manufacture liturgical objects, and to receive income. The decision was communicated directly to Alexei, the Patriarch of the Orthodox Church. 1946 saw Orthodox Christian seminaries reopened, as well as madrasas, to allow the training of Muslim clergy as well. That year also saw the first time since the October Revolution that the Quran was printed in Arabic. In 1953, 21 Soviet Muslims were allowed to go on Hajj. But since nothing is given for free, these permissions were granted in exchange for the total obedience of the Christian and Islamic clergy. These servants of religion were required to deny any past persecution and give their unconditional support to Soviet policies. The Orthodox Church even went so far as to declare Stalin a, quote, leader by divine right, end quote, as well as, quote, the true defender of the Holy Church, end quote. Meanwhile, Mullah Shakir Hilalidinov claimed that the world is divided into two camps, the camps of peace, headed by J.V. Stalin, and the camp of war, headed by the Anglo-American imperialists. If all the people unite in their struggle for peace, the imperialists will be unable to unleash war. Okay, but remember how I just said that the government continued to promote an anti-religious message? Well, they did, but their methodology changed. Education commissars in the republics, in the trade unions, the komsomols, and in newspaper and journals were under instructions to carry out scientific educational propaganda. The propaganda work of the Union of Militant Atheists was taken over by the Association for Dissemination of Political and Scientific Knowledge, more commonly referred to as simply Znaye, or knowledge. This marked a shift from attacking religion to instead promoting science and the struggle against superstition. Znaye organized lectures, discussions, and scientific conferences, and had representatives in workplaces and schools. Znaye also published books and distributed pamphlets to help in its campaign. In 1947, the Heart of Soviet Science, the Academy of Sciences, established a new department within the Institute of History. This was the Department on the History of Religion and Atheism, and it consistently published articles and books pushing an anti-religious message. Now, in the wake of Stalin's death, there was a short-lived flurry of anti-religious propaganda across the USSR. On the 7th of July, 1954, the Central Committee adopted the secret resolution entitled on the serious defects in scientific atheist propaganda and measures for the improvement thereof. The resolution was a harsh rebuke of the party's anti-religious work, pointing out the increasing influence of religion in the Soviet Union, especially in the rural areas. It noted the celebration of religious holidays, an increase in the participation in pilgrimages, as well as an overall rise in the religiousness of the population. It called out the impact of these things, including wasted man-hours, as well as the mass slaughter of livestock. The decree denounced the overwhelming degree to which religion was being tolerated on the grounds of the Leninist provision that religion could not be a private matter in a communist state, and that religion would not die out without rigorous propaganda. The resolution ordered active anti-religious work by the party structures, the Ministries of Culture and of Education, the Znaya Association, the Press, the Academy of Sciences, the Komsomols, and the trade unions. Concrete measures were proposed. The production of anti-religious films, the publishing and translation of books with anti-religious content, and the training of lecturers on atheism. The orders were to take material created and use it virtually everywhere, from labor collectives to sport clubs. On the 24th of July, 1954, Pravda's main article called for the energetic struggle against religion. This initiated a short but widespread campaign against mosques and churches. But it was a short-lived campaign. On November 10th, a new resolution was adopted, criticizing the mistakes of the previous resolution and the actions that had come from it. This new resolution expressed concern over the alienation of believers, most of whom were recognized as good Soviet citizens and even good communists. The new resolution called for limits placed on anti-religious propaganda, in that it should only be produced and promoted by those with a good knowledge of the subject, but should also only be targeted at teachers, artists, doctors, and other such professions. So basically, the intelligentsia who were in positions of influence over others in society. Okay, so how do we explain this implementation and then quick reversal from Soviet leadership? Well, it's likely heavily linked to the power struggle that followed Stalin's demise. Khrushchev, himself a devoted communist and ardent atheist, who believed in the Leninist approach to the eradication of religion, was not yet securely in power in 1954. In 1959, however, Khrushchev was firmly in control and a new campaign to undermine religious belief was launched. In the five-year period between the launch of the campaign and Khrushchev's removal from power, the Orthodox Church saw most of the rights they had gained during and after the war years stripped away. Churches were accused of breaking the law regarding the separation of church and state, and state organizations in charge of religious affairs were denounced for their soft stance. 1960 saw the removal of the chairman of the Council for Russian Orthodox Church Affairs, G. Karpov, and replaced by Vladimir Kuryedov, a much more strident atheist with no qualms about attacking religious power. At the same time that this happened, the Metropolitan, Nikolai, who had been the intermediary between the Council and the Orthodox Church, was removed and simply not replaced. And it wasn't just the Orthodox Church that was targeted, but also Baptist and evangelical communities. The state was reasserting itself to remove any potential threat to its own existence and supremacy. This included the banning of church attendance by anyone under the age of 18, as well as mandatory reporting by churches of any weddings and baptisms. 1959 saw half of the 20,000 operating churches in the Soviet Union closed, as well as 5 out of 8 seminaries. So, what was the effect of all this? Well, there's no easy or simple answer. Certainly, the aggressive anti-religious policies of the Soviet government over time did play a significant role in decreasing the role of religion in people's everyday lives. And it undoubtedly liquidated religion as a Soviet political force. For the people of the Soviet Union, it meant that ceremonies and celebrations that would have been religious in nature prior to the revolution were replaced with communist ceremonies and celebrations. Wedding palaces substituted churches when couples got married. Funerals were secular affairs. Religious holidays became a secondary afterthought, but were replaced by new holidays like May 1st, March 8th, New Year's, and the anniversary of the October Revolution. It can certainly be argued that these new holidays, however, really were substitutes, taking on almost religious-like meaning in the lives of people. One of the biggest long-term legacies, however, has been in the post-Soviet period. Religion, in most regions, does not play a significant political role. That isn't a universal truth, as in some regions, religion is quite important and political, but often can be seen as a pillar of support for the existing power structures rather than as an independent political force. Now, some of you have noticed we ended with Khrushchev. That's because he was the last Soviet leader to really try and tackle religion. Leaders after him took a more benign route, seeking peaceful coexistence of religion and communism. Certainly a far cry from the stridency of Lenin, but one much easier to pursue, as the Soviet Union by that time had been largely secularized. We're going to come back to the topic of religion in future episodes, as it played a huge role in the Cold War. The United States, a nation which had enshrined separation of church and state since its creation, doubled down on religion as a counter to Soviet atheism. The role of the church played a tremendous role in the breakdown and eventual liberation of Soviet satellite states like Poland and East Germany. The development and emergence of liberation theology in Central and South America would have profound and destabilizing effects across the region from the 1960s through to the present day. And of course, there is the role that Islam played in the anti-Soviet struggle in Afghanistan. Religion wasn't the sole factor in the collapse of Soviet power, but it did play a major role, one which we will be exploring further. We hope you've enjoyed today's episode, and to make sure you don't miss these future episodes, please make sure you're subscribed to our channel and have begun an aggressive campaign to decry the existence of all other bell buttons in order to promote and encourage the pressing of our bell button, the people's bell button. We can be reached via email at thecoldwarchannel@gmail.com, and we're also active on Facebook and Instagram at The Cold War TV. If you enjoy our work, your financial support would be greatly appreciated via www.patreon.com/thecoldwar or through YouTube membership. This is The Cold War Channel, and don't forget, the trouble with The Cold War is that it doesn't take too long before it becomes heated.